being tracked by bloodthirsty hound dogs and armed slave hunters who'd rather see you dead than free. In your quest for freedom, you will be whipped, chained, and returned to slavery. Most will die. Some will make it to freedom. For many blacks, Michigan was that key to escaping slavery. In the 1830s, Michigan, a part of the Northwest Territory, was a free state where opposition to slavery had become a powerful movement. In their attempts to flee to Canada, where they would obtain citizenship papers, slaves fleeing the southern states were harbored by Michigan whites and free blacks. These men and women financed and organized the Underground Railroad, an elaborate operation that would eventually lead some 60,000 slaves to freedom. Although this operation was illegal, it survived and prospered because of close family ties and the strong belief that slavery was wrong. The Underground Railroad got its name when pursuers of an escaping slave said he seemed to disappear after swimming the Ohio River. Slave hunters claimed he disappeared into an underground road. The road then became a railroad, and the abolitionists adopted railroad jargon for their network. The people helping the slaves were called conductors. Their hiding places were stations. The stations were the havens, homes, sheds, or barns, usually 10 to 20 miles apart. The slaves were normally transported at night in the bed of a wagon, where they would hide underneath cotton, corn, potatoes, sugar cane, and other farm produce. Since anyone found guilty of harboring a slave faced a maximum fine of $3,000, under the Fugitive Slave Law of 1850, few records of this elaborate escape network were kept. In fact, some abolitionists would not even tell their children what was taking place. Therefore, evidence detailing Michigan's role in the Underground Railroad is very vague. But there is enough evidence to conclude that the main route through Michigan was that route from Cassopolis, Michigan, through Marshall, Battle Creek, Port Huron, and then on to Sarnia, Ontario. It was the famous Adam Crosswhite case in Marshall, Michigan that led to more effective slave laws and ultimately the Fugitive Slave Law of 1850. Adam Crosswhite was born a slave in Kentucky, a mulatto. His mother, a slave girl. His father, her slave master. At the age of 7, Adam Crosswhite was given to his half-sister as a servant. She soon married an evil slave owner who enslaved Adam Crosswhite for 45 years. Around 1847, when the master began selling children on the plantation, Adam Crosswhite took his wife and children and escaped. They made their way up to Marshall, Michigan. There he got a job, built a house, and enrolled his children into the Marshall schools. Now the townspeople knew that Adam Crosswhite and his family were fugitives and that one day the slave hunters would come to claim their property. So they told Mr. Crosswhite if that was to occur, for him to take his shotgun and fire one warning shot, and they would come to his aid. Around 1847, a man by the name of Francis Troutman came to Marshall, Michigan, posing as an attorney, looking for a place to practice law. Now the townspeople grew weary of this man, thought perhaps he was a slave hunter. In fact, he was. One cold January morning, he descended upon Mr. Crosswhite's home to take him back under the Fugitive Slave Law of 1793, which was endorsed by President George Washington. But before he could capture Mr. Crosswhite, some 300 townspeople surrounded the evil Kentuckians. They were forced in jail, charged with breaking and entering, and assault and battery. Now, while they were being jailed, the rescuers took the Crosswhites by wagon to Jackson, Michigan. There they took a train to Detroit, where they stood until the conclusion of the trial. After the trial, the Kentuckians were forced out of Michigan without the Crosswhites. And of course, they were angry by this. They went to Kentucky and met with a young, fiery legislative attorney by the name of Henry Clay, who took this case before the floor of the U.S. Senate, resulting with the cross whites having to return to Kentucky to be enslaved again. With these direct lines from Marshall, Battle Creek, Port Huron, were interrupted, slaves then detoured through Oakland County to reach Detroit, their final stopping point before Windsor and Ontario. The Old House Inn on Dixie Highway in Springfield Township is a station. It was said to have harbored slaves. A secret stairway leads to a room in the loft of this house. This house now is a restaurant and a private residence. According to research done in 1915 by Lillian Drake Avery, former president of the Oakland County Pioneer and Historical Society, the principal station in Oakland County was in Farmington, and Nathan Powers was the conductor. It was believed Farmington had at least 8 stations. Leaders of the underground movement, like Sojourner Truth, spoke at various times in Farmington, according to early writings of Mrs. Avery. According to research, the first house used to harbor slaves in Farmington, which is this house, was the Philbrick Tavern at 11 Mile and Powers Road, and I'll get to that house later on. This house was also used to harbor slaves. It's located on Pontiac Trail near Orchard Lake. It's a private-owned residence now, owned by the former publisher of the Open Press, Bruce McIntyre. A 12-inch opening on the right interior wall of an enclosure for built-in drawers leads to a secret room in this house that was said to have harbored slaves. The Philbrick Tavern at 11 Mile and Cross Road was also a station. The house was owned by Nathan Philbrick. It was large and rumbling and was adjacent to a swamp. It supposedly had rooms and cellars and holes in walls where slave chains were embedded. But no one has been able to clearly understand why fleeing slaves would be placed in chains. This house, now a private residence, was used as a meeting place for town hall meetings, and was also one of the finer hotels in Oakland County during the early 1800s. Another Farmington location said to harbor slaves was the Farmington Community Center, or the Lowmaker House. This house was operated by Palmer Sherman, who in the early 1800s shared the following story with Mrs. Avery about her research during the Underground Railroad. One day shortly before the Civil War began, I went to the barn and found 13 blacks camping on my freshly gathered hay. They were part of the people my uncle Nathan Power didn't have room to hide. They were unsure if they were free and were still hiding. The blacks were headed for Grosse Pointe and Detroit. One of the places in Detroit used to harbor slaves was the Second Baptist Church on Monroe Street in Detroit's Greek town. This 160-year-old church is probably one of the oldest in North America. It was established by 13 ex-former slaves. The pastor, William Monroe, was an abolitionist and operated the church. One of its members, George D. Baptiste, was a black businessman and operated and owned the T. Whitney, a ship that was used to take the slaves across the Detroit River into Canada. Another Detroit location said to harbor slaves was the Finney Hotel, owned by Seymour Finney. At the rear of this hotel was a barn where Seymour Finney would hide slaves in that barn until they could. And that place is located at Griswold Street, several blocks from this site on the Detroit River, where he would take the slaves across the river to freedom. This is the monument that stands on the boardwalk or the riverwalk there in Detroit. This was the actual site where Mr. George Baptiste would take the slaves across the river to freedom. You could imagine how the slaves felt at this point. But they could see freedom. They could breathe freedom. They could taste freedom. And they oftentimes expressed their joys of being free in song and dance. Those old Negro spirituals that many of us are familiar with, some that we hear on Sunday mornings, that our ancestors would sing, songs like Wade in the Water. There were meanings in those songs, because those songs oftentimes orchestrated escape plans. When the masters felt the slaves weren't communicating, they oftentimes communicated in song and dance. Listen to the words of this song, as you may realize how those words were used. Wade in the water, wade, in the water, children, wade, in the water, God's gonna trouble the water, wade, in the water, wade, in the water, children, wade, in the water, God's gonna trouble the water. And when they sang these songs, they were telling each other, tonight when we escape, we're going to escape by water. You know why? Bloodhounds can't pick up your scent if you're in the water. So, slaves were clever, because they wanted to be free. Now, oftentimes, the Negro spirituals, those words used, were misused or mispronounced, but they're not to be laughed at, because you must understand that these people, the slaves, were uprooted from their homeland, their motherland, stripped of their culture, stripped of their dignity, but they sang anyway. And they sang as if God Almighty himself had descended his golden chariot from heaven to take them home to glory.